but standing by my window on a cold and cloudy day, when I saw that hearse come rolling for to carry my mother away. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home waiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. This lady you are holding, Lord, I hate to see her go. Will the circle be broken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home waiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. The circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by. There's a better home waiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
Hi, if you're new, sorry, it's just me. I've been gone, but I'm back. welcome to worship at First Baptist Church this morning. To those of you who are here in person, we say good morning and welcome. To all of those joining worship online, we say good morning and welcome to you as well. As we celebrate this third Sunday of Easter, and in particular, we say good morning and thank you so much to AFTA students who are helping to lead in worship. We're thrilled to have you, grateful for your leadership. Thank you so much for being here with us. If you would, in the pew in front of you, there is a card that we would love to know. If you are newer to our congregation, we'd love to learn a little bit more about you and reach out and say hello to all people. We would love to share the joys and concerns that make up life. So if you would fill those out, I mean, you can put them in the offering basket or hand them to a minister as we depart. So I'd invite you to join me in continuing to worship as we pray the invocation in this morning's bulletin. Let's pray. Living God, long ago, faithful women proclaimed the good news of Jesus' resurrection, and the world was changed forever. Teach us to keep the faith with them, that our witness may be as bold, our love as deep.
Would you please join me as we read a prayer for illumination? God of amazing surprises, whose proclamation of peace through the risen Christ washes over us with refreshing joy, we are eager to see Jesus and to trust that the life we know through him is worth emulating. Put us in touch with truth that cleanses and makes whole so we can relate to others in ways that reconcile and redeem. Amen. And here now, reading from Psalm 4. Answer me when I call, O God of my right. You gave me room when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. How long, you people, shall my honor suffer shame? How long will you love vain words and seek after lies? But know that the Lord has set apart the faithful for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. When you are disturbed, do not sin. Ponder it on your beds and be silent. Offer right sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. There are many who say, oh, that we might see some good. Let the light of your face shine on us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart more than when their grain and wine abound. I will both lie down and sleep in peace, for you alone, O Lord, make me lie down in safety. The psalmist is praying for peace that we seek sometimes, the solace at night. And here we have a chance to also seek peace and to make it by sharing the ancient words, the peace of Christ be with you, and responding and also with you. So wherever you are, would you please stand if you're able and turn to those around you and share the peace of Christ.
Our New Testament lesson comes from the Gospel according to Luke. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." They then told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering. And he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. These are the concluding lines of the Apostles' Creed, one of the global church's most commonly used confessions of faith. I've taken my title from the second to last line, the resurrection of the body. This is a sermon about the resurrection of the body. Jesus' resurrected body. Why it matters that Jesus rose bodily from the dead, and why the resurrection of the body matters for all creation. Luke makes it plain in his verse 2 of his last chapter. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. We're familiar with the legal term habeas corpus, Latin for to have the body of, or show me the body. But on Easter morning, the women who happened first among the tomb might have said, non habemus corpus. We do not have the body. You may remember from that Easter Sunday morning how also Mary says it out loud. They've taken the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they've laid him. Combine these post-resurrection accounts and we hear a consistent concern. What happened to the body of our Lord and Savior? Habeas corpus. Show me the body. There were other bodies in the tomb, two men in dazzling clothes. They say to the women, why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here. He's risen. He's alive. He's present again and walking the earth. But where is he? Where's the body? Later that same day, two of them are on a day's walk to the village of Emmaus when a stranger, capital S, begins walking alongside them. What are y'all talking about? The stranger asks. The question stops them in their tracks. Their long faces give rise to their sadness. One of them, Cleopas, looks at the stranger and without recognizing that it's Jesus in the flesh, says to him, have you been living under a rock? Have you not heard about everything that's been happening in Jerusalem for the last several days? The stranger plays dumb. What things? And they tell the story to the one who already knows. Well, the women came back and told us he was alive, but we went there, we didn't see him. Then the stranger lets them have it. How foolish you are, and how slow of heart. Nevertheless, they still invite him in for supper. They've learned something about being kind and hospitable. And there at the table, the stranger breaks the bread, blesses it, breaks it, gives it to them, and they see him. They see Jesus. There's the body. We have a body. And then he vanishes. Just as soon as they recognize him, there goes the body again. Soon enough, he's back among them. Peace be with you. And Luke reports they thought that they were seeing a ghost. Jesus sounds almost hurt by this sense that he gleans from them that he's merely an apparition. Why are you frightened? Why do you doubt? He asks. Look at my hands, my feet. See, it's me. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones like I have. I love Jesus' emphasis on the senses here. Look, touch, see, flesh, bones. Here we have a body. The novelist John Updike also challenged those of us who believe the resurrection was merely a figment of the disciples' imagination, a collective remembrance, a psychic phenomenon. No, Updike writes, it was not as the flowers, each soft spring recurrent. It was not as his spirit in the mouths of the fuddled eyes of the 11 apostles. It was as his flesh, ours. Jesus died in the flesh. Jesus rose from the dead in the flesh. Now here's the fun part. After he showed them his hands and his feet, Jesus asks, got anything to eat? Now zoom in with me on this moment and let's marvel together at this astonishing, strange, and humorous sight. Minutes ago, the disciples, you remember, discussing with feverish excitement the report from others that he was alive. Now he's with them as a body among them, and they've just handed him a piece of broiled fish. Jesus takes it, eats it right in front of them. Here Jesus is, in the flesh, eating. Here is the one they'd seen arrested. and crucified and buried and hidden behind a stone tomb and sealed officially by the Roman Empire. And now he's snacking on a fish fillet sandwich. Why does Luke include this detail? Why not simply offer the details of Jesus' physical body? He's flesh and he's bone. He's not a ghost. Why go this extra step to say the thing about the fish? Why mention lunch? In her essay, Jesus' Resurrected Gut Biome, Mennonite pastor and author Melissa Flohr Bixler imagines that we have seen in Jesus' resurrected body the first fruits of the kind of bodies we will have in the new creation. The women, she says, come to the tomb with spices, expecting the smell of Jesus' bacteria, engaging in a final act of mutualism. That's a very rosy way of putting it, isn't it? They expect to find the results of competition between microbial organisms that would eventually return Jesus to the dust from which he came. The women came expecting corruption, but within hours, they are witnessing the body that they expected to be decaying, living and breathing and eating. This one verse in Luke about Jesus eating fish in the resurrection opens up for us a small but very bright window into God's plans for all of creation, including, I suppose, bacteria. All of creation, all of it will be redeemed in God's time. Jesus is the first to show us what this will look like. In the redeemed creation to come, we will not be disembodied bulbs of light floating around for eternity. We will have bodies. We will eat and drink and create and enjoy and live without any fear of competition, corruption, or death. I cannot tell you the rest of the details because they're hidden behind a veil from all of us. But I believe Luke offers this delectable detail because he has seen in Jesus' resurrected body a glimpse of our physical, material destiny in God. Jesus' meal of broiled fish is a foretaste of redeemed creation and creatures. You and I. Well, that's a nice thought, Pastor, but I'm feeling right now like it's time for lunch myself. Resurrected and perishable bodies, good news. Redeemed creation, wonderful. Energizing, hopeful. But what does this good news do for us now? I grew up in church, knowing a wonderful man named Nelson Blackwell. And to this day, I think of him when I think of the phrase salt of the earth. He was a good neighbor, a gardener. He could make Brunswick stew that has only yet to be matched by my brother Scott's Brunswick stew. But he got the recipe from Nelson. A hospitable husband and father, a wise churchman, even though he served on my ordination council. All right. Okay. He was a big guy with large, tough hands, fingers thick with muscle from a life of work and tilling and planting. And to shake his hand, which I did for the last time on Christmas Eve, 2015, when he came through the line after I had preached in my home church and gave me a wink and a smile. To shake his hand was like shaking hands with a porterhouse steak. And when he retired, most anyone who knew him would have expected him to spend his golden years gardening and, I don't know, piddling. But in his late 60s, early 70s, he began taking piano lessons. And even though he had gray hair and a lifetime behind him, and even though his fingers were as wide as two keys, he learned to play the piano, if for no other reason than to enjoy it and to be a source of joy for others. There's a reason that the very last song, maybe the psalm that ushers us into heaven, if you will, ends with praise him with trumpet sound, praise him with lute and harp, praise him with tambourine and dance, praise him with strings and pipe, clanging cymbals, loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that breathes praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Did you know that Toni Morrison didn't write her first novel until she was 40? Rodney Dangerfield, I don't give no respect. 46 when he broke through on Johnny Carson. Julia Child was 50 when she wrote her first cookbook. Betty White, 51 when she made it big on the Mary Tyler Moore Show. Grandma Moses started painting at 78. One of her paintings sold 15 or so years ago for over $1 million. Harry Bernstein wrote his beloved memoir when he was 96. The bodily resurrection whispers to us, when this perishable body puts on imperishability and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? And that has already commenced. So, we may say with great confidence, each one of us, now, I believe and am living into my belief in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Thank you. to go to that gospel feast that promised land where all is
Will you pray with me? Living God, in the power of the resurrection, you come to us along the road and around the table so that we may know true communion with you. You show us your hands so that we may reach out to mend the broken. You show us your feet so that we may walk with those the world passes by. You show us your face so we may know what our sisters and brothers look like. You open our eyes so we may see God's love. You open our minds so we may welcome God's word. You open our lips so we may be God's witnesses. As you come to us, you bring us peace. So we pray for the places where there is no peace. Countries torn by war, refugees seeking homes, prisoners facing torture. You bring us peace. And so we pray for peace to the tensions and conflicts within us, to the regrets and failures, to broken relationships, to lost friendships. As you come to us, you bring peace, for you are a friend to us when we are alone, when we are lonely. In these moments, unseen, you are there. God, you call us out of our darkened hideaways into the light of your world as emissaries of hope, justice, peace, and compassion. And so be with us as we participate in ministries of healing and hope through this church, in our community, in our state, our nation, and the world. Give us courage and strength to be your disciples in all the circumstances of our lives. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's time we all knew that whether we're not yet 1 year old, or even if we're over 100, we're just getting started. And Jesus tells us this, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it falls in the earth and dies, it multiplies 100 and 1,000-fold and gives so much more abundant life. So what's to prevent any of you who have not yet from coming forward and dying in the waters of baptism and being raised to new life, to flourish and to get a head start on this thing called eternal life? If you will, we invite you to come forward today or soon. Join up with God's church. Be made into a new creation. The invitation is open today and always. Let us stand together and sing our last hymn.
Good morning. I'm Nicole Sumter, and I'm the Assistant Director of AFTA. Karen Sorrells had to unexpectedly take her mother to the hospital this morning. She is there with her now, and everything is fine, just some tests being run. Karen is very sorry to not be able to offer you her heartfelt words, but I'm going to read them to you in her absence. Anniversaries are wonderful events. They allow us to celebrate our past, consider our present, and create our future. These wonderful milestones are where we pause for reflection on accomplishments, goals met, struggles, and celebrations along the way. It's also the moment we prepare for the future. The Academy for the Arts will celebrate 10 years this August. With much to be grateful for, we are as motivated today by our mission and core values as we were when we first opened our doors in August of 2014. All those years ago, your vision as a church was twofold: to wrap our arms around Asheville and to move the music and worship life of FPCA beyond its walls. The Academy for the Arts is born from this vision and has been guided by it since its inception. With a brilliant and celebrated faculty to lead them, our students achieve musical success and are actively engaged and are open to new and exciting experiences. They are top scholars, disciplined workers, and very generous in sharing their time and sharing their talents. Our students have performed in numerous churches in our community, in nursing care facilities, and have performed on stages like Shindig on the Green, the Sourwood Festival, and Merlefest. They're award-winning musicians and recording artists. While most of our students hail from Buncombe and neighboring counties, we are a wonderfully diverse community, an international melting pot with student families from Korea, Thailand, China, Russia, Moldova, Ukraine, Spain, Bali, and England. With our students and faculty, we've celebrated births, weddings, graduations from kindergarten, high school, and college. We've heard stories about new puppies and family vacations. With them, we have grieved over the loss of a child, a parent, or a grandparent. We have walked with them through divorce, cancer diagnosis, and other difficult medical conditions. We have held hands, hugged, and prayed with families whose extended families lived in war zones. We have partnered with numerous programs and organizations in our community. Our own Crossroads Ministry, ABCCM, Manna Food Bank, where donations from a benefit concert by our AFTA faculty provided over 4,500 meals to help fight food insecurity in Western North Carolina. Partnering with three Slavic churches in our community, AFTA collected over $5,000 in cash donations and medical supplies that were sent directly to the partnering churches in Ukraine, Moldova, and Poland to provide food, medical supplies, mattresses, blankets, clothing, and other needed items. We have an ongoing partnership with Black Mountain Home for Children, where our students have performed for countless events. And we have awarded over $150,000 in need-based scholarships. As our Academy students share with us today in worship today, they represent over 260 students, 23 faculty members, and a host of volunteers as they offer expressions of gratitude for the support you have provided in so many generous ways. And as we look back on these 10 years of tremendous growth, struggles, achievements, we feel confident AFTA will continue to write new chapters of excellence, innovation, and creativity. We look forward to a year of celebrating, and we hope that you will join us in that celebration, because we know our success story is incomplete without the families and friends who have supported us along the way. You are part of that. So thank you, First Baptist, for your encouragement, support, friendship, and for your vision all those years ago. Thank you.
Lord, it is a terrific day to be in church. Wow. We thank you for so many gifts. Please accept all of our offerings. May every note that is sung, every chord that is played, the word that has been proclaimed, every cent invested, and every moment shared for the sake of others this week, may they all bring you glory. In the name of the risen Christ, we pray. Amen.
With heartfelt thanks on behalf of the church to you, Nicole, speaking to us, of course, on behalf of Karen, but thank you to you as well for your wisdom and leadership of this wonderful organization. Thank you for bringing this fine word from Karen, and also to you, Clark. Please pass on our thanks to Karen for her leadership and for yours for 10 years. The Academy for the Arts continues to bless our church and our community. And know, too, of our prayers for Eulene, for her healing and restoration. Welcome back, Mom. Yeah, wonderful to have you back, Laura, and Casey back from his first leg of sabbatical, feeling like the team is here again. It feels good. One announcement this afternoon at 4 o'clock, we'll be in the chapel welcoming a group from around the region for a documentary screening of the Baptist, provided by the Baptist Women in Ministry. Executive Director Meredith Stone will be here from Texas. Executive Coordinator for CBF North Carolina, Larry Hobus, will be here. This is a screening that tells the story, the quite difficult story, of Baptist women in ministry across the last many decades. It's a powerful documentary. I invite you to come and enjoy the power of this story. It's moving and inspiring. Again, that's here this afternoon, 4 p.m. in the chapel. Now God be in your head and in your understanding. God be in your eyes and in your looking. God be in your mouth and in your speaking. God be in your heart and in your thinking. God be at your end and at your departing, now and forever. Amen.